Hello everyone, and welcome back to my Realism Overhaul series in Kerbal Space Program 0.24.2. In this episode, I hope to test a new launcher out of Baikonur and also deliver a geosynch sat that will help us with future interplanetary missions as well as lunar missions, because our communication network is not quite up to par. But first of all, let me introduce our new rocket, the Jord. Jord was the Norse goddess of the Earth, so quite appropriate for a geosynch sat. And it actually can carry much more than the satellite it's carrying right now. The geosynch sat is only 1.5 tons. I think this thing can carry more than 6 tons easily. And the base engine is actually one of the Buran engines, the Energia, sorry. Of course, the Energia was the one that had the engines in the Buran system. And so the core stage of the Energia, which is equivalent to the Space Shuttle's main engine, so it's got a very high ISP both at sea level and in vacuum, and it's got the huge gimbal range, which I hope won't cause any problems, because I can't do tweakable gimbal, and SAS hates widely gimbling engines. But anyway, the RD0120, and a little bit less thrust than the Space Shuttle main engines, a little bit lighter than the Space Shuttle main engines, still very highly throttleable, which is good because we aren't carrying a very heavy payload. So you can see our thrust weight ratio gets a bit high, so being able to throttle that engine is critical. You can see that burns for almost 4 minutes, which gets us quite a ways into our orbit. And then in the second stage, I've got an RL10B2 that is standing in for the RD0146. Still haven't figured out what's up with the 0146, but the RL10B2 is roughly equivalent, a little bit more thrust. So we've talked about that in the previous episode. And so I think it's a reasonable replacement, and it's sitting in there. It will take the satellite the rest of the way, all the way into geosync, I think. It should be able to do most of it, but the satellite itself has its own little thruster, so it can do that, but I don't want to be sitting through 45 minutes worth of burning, so hopefully the second stage can handle most of it. And so yeah, it's a fairly light rocket compared to what I've been launching recently. Only 131.5 tons is nothing compared to what I've been doing, but then again, it's launching something fairly light in the first place. So, alright, everything is spoken for, so let's try and launch this. I thought about launching a satellite into Molniya orbit, but first we want to make sure that we've got, that's more for coverage of the planet. We need coverage in terms of being able to communicate with other missions. Well, I guess the Molniya orbit would have helped too, but that's not the plan right now. So we're going to try and put something into geosync. We're probably going to reduce our inclination just a bit, but we're not going to be able to do it all the way. So yeah, I think that's all the basics spoken for, and let's try this new rocket out. I don't know if it's going to work or not. I just put it together, and we will see whether there's some critical flaw. Alright, so out to launch pad. Okay, so here we are on a dawn launch. No particular azimuth in mind, so we're just going to be launching out from here. SAS on, throttle is up, and all our fuel seems to be loaded properly, hopefully. And make sure that that engine is the right engine. Alright, I think we're ready to go. Let's see. It's a little bit squat. It looks a lot taller and leaner in the VAB. The launch pad puts on some pounds, apparently. So might want to trim that up, and instead of making it such a fat rocket. I'll think about that. Anyway, let's try out the systems first then. Okay. Okay, not bad. And we have positive vertical velocity, or speed. Well, I specified direction, so I guess it's velocity. Mach 1. A little bit high for Mach 1. Should have done the pitch program a little bit quicker. pretty good simulation rate. Yeah, pretty much real time actually. Having very few engines, of course. This time we only have one engine base stage, one engine on the second stage. Seems to help a bit. And of course, no obviously glitchy engines. So. Okay, we're getting close to 4Gs here, so I'm gonna start throttling back. I don't know if this engine actually has continuous throttling, I assume so. You know, maybe it's time for me to figure out how to recover some of these stages. Probably should put in some sort of mod for that, like FMRS or one of those. That might be a new project. Also, I noticed that I don't have Infernal Robotics in this install. That's a bit of a problem. Should probably add that in as well. We are working with 64-bit here, so there's theoretically room for more mods, though you never know what might cause a hiccup, and we have issues as it is. Uh-oh, speaking of issues. We have Wigglies. Oh. Don't know why that is. I've kept the G-forces under control. Why should it be wiggling out now? Oh, we'll just have to... the fairings still don't separate. I forgot the fairing separation earlier. Alright, before this goes wildly out of control, let's jettison that. Hello? Okay. And... But it looks like we're pretty far out of control, so let me turn on RCS to get us controlled first, and then fire the RL-10. There we go. I did not neglect second stage RCS. Okay, looks like we're oriented fine. We seem to be going quite high. Gonna extend the AIES antenna as usual. There we go. Now, this is basically the same as my previous geosync sat, except I added an extra CL1 dish. We're gonna have one facing Kerbin, and we're gonna have the other facing the moon. And finally, the main dish, of course, active vessel. I did put the snap RTGs, even though they look really huge and ungainly. Not the most photogenic RTGs on the planet, but... And that's actually where I realized that I didn't have Infernal Robotics in this, because I wanted to put them on a strut and a hinge, because then I could extend them further out and make it look a little bit better, but now they're just sort of little packs on the side of that thing. So, not quite as good looking. Okay, not the most ideal burn in terms of getting into orbit. 292 by 212. But we're going to end up in a much broader orbit anyway, matching our other geosync sat. Yeah, I think an inclined orbit would be fine. I mean, I guess it wouldn't stay over Baikonur, obviously, but that's fine. There's plenty of upper hemisphere mission controls now, so And then otherwise it might... Maybe I should actually have it make a dedicated connection to another geosync. Darn, I should have thought of that. I should put an extra dish on for that. But, oh well. Yeah. I don't know if I should flatten it out or not. I don't see any compelling reason to. Since we wouldn't be able to communicate with Baikonur anyway if I tried to flatten out the inclination. I know purists will not like this. They will want a geostationary thing. Or a Molniya orbit, or some orbit that everybody else has already done. Whatever. So once again, do not tell me in the comments that I should have flattened this orbit out, okay? That's not the plan. We've got lots of satellites. What we don't have is one in this sort of orientation. The pulsats, if you recall, got messed up anyway. I don't know if there seems to be one operating here, but I don't think it's... Well, it looks like TDRS polar seems alright, but if I actually turn to it, it would probably run out of electric charge or blow up or something, because that's a very old satellite. And again, with the huge number of mission controls available, it's not a bad idea. We'll probably be connecting to Australia for quite a lot of it, because as it swings below the Earth. But anyway. And in fact, if it doesn't connect through to one of the mission controls, it could connect to any of these other satellites too. Possibly. Okay, anyway. Let's see, how much juice do we have left? Plenty for this burn, and probably for the beginning of the further burn. I really should have started this earlier, but it actually isn't so sensitive. Let's see, very stable. Alright, let's go. Seems to be a huge imbalance between the hydrogen and oxygen on this stage. Seems to be misconfigured. Okay. A little bit late on shutting that down, but I'm going to use RCS to adjust our apoapsis. Really severe gap between the H2 and oxygen. We're not carrying any hydrogen or oxygen in the payload, so I think I must have tried out a different engine here and configured for that first. Or I accidentally configured it for the RD0120 instead of for the RL10. Okay. Now, obviously, we're not going to be sitting above Baikonur the whole time. So, it's sort of a weird sort of situation that we've got here. What we're really aiming to do is just have an inclined... the goal is to have something in an inclined orbit around Earth that won't be as obstructed by Earth's bulk itself. So we're sort of putting it into a high orbit so that it will not be on the opposite side of Earth from our active mission, as often as something that's closer to the Earth. I mean, something that's in a really tight orbit will be blocked by the Earth about half the time, but something in a high orbit is going to be free to communicate. I'd say that it's probably going to be blocked about 10% of the time, maybe. Maybe less, probably less than that. So that's the goal. I mean, it's just arbitrary that I'm putting it into a 24-hour orbit. Which brings up another point. I haven't tried out putting something into a one-year orbit yet. I was wondering if that was possible. The problem with trying that out is that we're going to have to wait a long time. I mean, if you figure it, if it's going to a one-year orbit and see if it's possible to have a one-year orbit around the Earth, then it's going to take like maybe 3 months to get up to apoapsis before we do our circularization burn. The other option is to put it into a non-circular orbit, which we can do pretty much immediately, but that won't have the same feel to it. It won't be a sort of a pseudo-Lagrange point. So yeah. That's an idea. Anyway, let me plot out the circularization here. And it's still connecting through the little NRS or TDRS satellites that we have in orbit, so that's also good. But this might only be because we're active vessel. Some of those other satellites might be told to communicate through active vessel, and that means that when we turn away from this mission, these sort of connections might not actually be active and available. Okay, let's try this out. Still says very stable. I'm going to light one of the sets of solid rocket boosters anyway, just to make use of them. This is reading the hydrogen, so once we run out of oxygen, gotta be out of luck on that. Okay, yeah. Oh yeah, I guess we could run out the RCS fuel that we still have here. It's only part of the MMHN204 we have, but it's quite a lot actually. I should actually use less here. Should empty this tank out before future launches. On heavier launches it'll definitely be necessary to keep this tank empty. Well, mostly empty. Okay, but I guess we can hold off on that. Let's extend solar panels. About time we did that. Okay, so amazingly enough, we're now at a orbital period of over 23 hours and only a little bit left to burn here, but wow, we've got a lot of MMHN204 left over here. Just goes to show, high density fuels, don't underestimate them even if they have low ISP. ISP times density can be a very telling factor, even though what you're talking about is more mass. That tiny little tank is giving us quite a lot of delta V here. So yeah, it looks like our probe, our satellite, will have all of its fuel intact as we get to an orbital period of 23 hours and 56 minutes. Forget how many seconds it is, but this is reasonably good enough, I think. As long as it maintains some angle apart from the other geosynch sat, it'll be alright. And it will do that. Yeah, it'll be a very interesting orbit. We'll see. Hopefully it'll stay connected properly. But yeah, we're going to just discard this other stage and free the satellite to do its thing. Okay, so here we go. Changed our numbers a little bit, so let's fix that. It's a pretty strong decoupling. Oh, right, SmartESS is trying to fight me on this. Probably right around there will be fine. Okay, so we've got that going for us. And now let's see what else we can do. So geosync sat in orbit and hopefully supplementing our communications. But now we have to turn to bigger and better things. Well, planetary alignment isn't particularly our strong suit here. Our planets are all over the place. We would want Mars to be somewhere over here right now. We would want Venus to be actually about here-ish. Mercury, we would want to be around here in its orbit with relation to us. Jupiter, we would actually want here. Saturn around here. And then Uranus around here. Yeah, so that's a bit tough. I guess the thing to do would be to time warp and see which one ends up there first. Moho or slash Mercury would probably be the one. Can't say I'm entirely thrilled with that prospect. But okay. No, that's a 45 degree angle. I don't want to try a Jupiter transfer at that. We don't have any Kerbals in weird locations, so that's a plus. Though our satellites are going to go all over the place. Okay, so it would seem that we have this opportunity to send something to Mercury. Not a real test of our RTG, of course, because, well, frankly, the RTG is necessary once you're getting that close to the sun. But I'm hankering for some sort of interplanetary journey, so let's see what kind of rocket I can cook up. Okay, so this is going to be Mercury Probe 2. We've sent one over to Mercury before, but that only carried a gravioli detector and some thermometers. And so we didn't get too much science out of that. Of course, that one crashed into the surface of Mercury. This one, as you can see, is trying to carry a Science Junior and two goo containers. The trouble with this, of course, is that I don't know if this actually has enough Delta V to hit Mercury. It's going to be a close call. It might not. So we might have to be a little bit lucky here. I'm not too sure this is going to work out. But with Mercury, it's always a huge Delta V cost. And it's tough to say whether we're going to make it or not. It depends on the relative position of Mercury's periapsis to Earth's periapsis around the Sun, and how the inclinations work out. If we happen to be at an ascending or descending node, I haven't checked that yet. And so it's all very complicated orbital dynamics, whether this is enough Delta V to actually hit Mercury. Mercury is one of the more sensitive planets. It's easier in terms of calculations to calculate the stuff for the outer planets. That's actually relatively easy compared to something that moves quickly like Mercury and has also a very, relatively high inclination. Okay, so, well, this is our rocket. We'll try it out. Mercury Probe 2 on the bow of the rocket. Well, I think that's all that I need to say. Let's try this out. Okay, so the inclination is going to be an additional trick with this launch. Of course, we're launching out of Baikonur, and so it's a little bit trickier to align with the plane of the system. But we've minimized our relative inclination to the moon, so that'll be step one. And otherwise, everything looks ready to go. We've got our fuel. The TTEB on the NK43 is closed. Okay, throttle up. SAS is on. We've got a little bit more lag than usual. It is the RL10 on the second stage, by the way. Again, standing in for the RD0146. And here we go. Uh-oh. Wow. Lots of gimbling. Wow, what is this? This is bad. Why is it gimbling so much? This is not good, this is not good. Okay, SAS off. Okay, I've got manual control here. Trying to, at least. This is bad. SAS did not handle the gimbling very well, I think. I think that was the main problem. I wonder why. Smart ASS seems to have it, but SAS was gimbling all over the place. The payload is strutted down. That's, I mean, otherwise it would have flopped right out just there. Huh. How strange. Okay, well, that particular crisis over, it seems. We are on our way. I've noticed that a recent version of FAR disables itself on 64-bit. So that essentially means, I hope it does, well, based on our Delta V to orbit and how things have been performing, I assume it doesn't do that in this version of FAR that I have installed here. But I would like to know which version of FAR that started out at, because that means that basically I can't install that version of FAR in any 64-bit install. It's important to know. Now, with this Mercury mission, of course, we have an advantage in that we're not using signal delay at this point because of the computer being a little bit iffy. We do have a downside, though, in that we're carrying much more mass to Mercury, or attempting to at least, and we do not have as much delta V. We're about 2,000 meters per second less than the previous mission, perhaps even less than that. So we're short on delta V. And that's probably the more critical issue. Signal delay is not nearly as serious as not having as much delta V. And of course, the way we just launched with all the wiggles probably suggests that we've burned quite a bit more than that already. It's funny, I mean, on previous launches we didn't have any problem with SAS taking control initially and then switching to Smart ASS at around 300 meters above the ground. So I wonder why I had some problem now. It must be the payload, but the payload is, I did add struts to support the payload, make sure it didn't wiggle or anything. Okay, unlocking the T-tib on the NK-43. Throttling down the engines. Going to 35 degrees and igniting the NK-4. Oh, we've got some wiggles. Huh, I thought throttling the engines would actually reduce wiggles, but it doesn't seem to. Anyway, NK-43. Ignite. It doesn't want me to. No, it still doesn't want me to. I pressed the space bar. There we go. Ooh, weird. Seems like there's more wiggling this time. Considering what happened at launch, I'm not entirely surprised. But we need to deal with it. The question is whether throttling down will help deal with it, or whether throttling up will. Gotta turn on the RCS. Wow, I think it's getting worse. Huh. We've got the aerodynamic strakes trying to keep things together, but we still got a lot of deviation in all dimensions. Pitch, roll, yaw, all varying greatly. Seems like this might be too tall a fairing for this rocket. It's not too heavy a payload, of course, because the mass is still about the same as our lunar masses that we have launched at the moon. Okay, boosters off, throttling up the NK-43, and booster separation. Okay, the NK-43 is like going crazy. Why? I'm gonna take Smart ASS off. Alright, I'm gonna drop the fairings, I think. Oh, so much for that idea. Yes, I have the... Well, the most updated version for 24.2 is installed, and the top fairing has been replaced. I mean, it's not the same top fairing that we used previously, I think, so... Okay, let's see if SAS can deal with this better. It looks more stable right now. Okay, well, we'll go with SAS then. Okay, and we really need more pitch than this. Okay, maybe we can knock those fairings off. And the way it's going, it might not make it to orbit. Well, I don't trust Smart ASS right now. Okay, I think we've caught it. I think we might have to burn some of the second stage in order to get into orbit, but it's close. Might be possible just to get into orbit with this stage. So, at launch, SAS messed up and Smart ASS saved it. And now, when the boosters dropped off, Smart ASS messed up and SAS was the one to go with. I don't know. Don't know what's up with these two. Ultimately, it's about the gimbling of the engines and whether they can just to handle it smoothly, or whether it gets into a sort of a feedback loop, whether it ends up having ever-increasing oscillations. And that's just a matter of the programming, actually, and how it's designed to deal with perturbations in our trajectory. Will it overcompensate or not? If we end up in orbit on this stage, it's going to be a tight orbit. Well, let me just turn off SAS. And the yaw wiggle ends. Roll doesn't, though. But there's no yaw wiggle if SAS is disengaged. Okay, here we go. And just short of orbit. Okay. Well, there's numerous ways we can deal with that. Let's see now. Right, these also go off. Make sure that happens. Alright, let's dump this stage. Right, and now I'm gonna push away using RCS. And I guess we'll use one relight of the RL10. No choice here. Gotta get this going. Alright, so throttle up and burn. Our abwapsis is gonna go a little bit. Okay, well, this is not a very good orbit at all, but I guess I'm gonna have to take it given all the problems that we've been having. Alright, so now it gets interesting. Can I figure out how to transfer to Mercury from this location? We need to go down this way. And we are highly inclined. Let's see. Well, that's not too bad, actually. Somehow we end up with an 8-degree inclination difference. And it's further away from the sun, so that's good. What's the delta V on this burn? Okay. Oh, at 10.6. That looks pretty good. I mean, we gotta meet up with it at the sending node too. That has other benefits. Let's see. Okay, so I've got something plotted here. We've got a periapsis around Mercury of 33,828 kilometers. Pretty high, but Mercury is a tough one to hit with any accuracy. And the cost is, the initial burn is 6,357. And then the mid-course plane change, which is thankfully further than the orbit of Venus this time, is a mere 2,846. It seems like we have enough delta V for these two burns, just barely. But if we can get our Science Junior to a reasonable location compared to Mercury, that would be good. Wow, it's bright. Okay, so, but we'll have to do these burns pretty accurately. And I'm not going to do that in this episode because I am getting a little bit tired here. And I want to make sure I'm fresh and we can do this all properly. So on that note, tune in next time to see what happens with this Mercury mission and what science we get back and how I choose to spend it. I'm already thinking about that. Maybe it's a case of not counting your chickens before they've hatched. But anyway, thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please do press like. If you have any comments or suggestions, please leave them in the comment section below. And I'll see you next time.